on behalf of Ortho TV. Hello, very good evening, friends. We are going to start ASAMI India's first webinar on behalf of Ortho TV and ASAMI India. Now I am handing over the webinar to our moderator, Dr. Manish Dhawan, sir. Over to Manish, sir.
Good evening, everyone, and I'm really happy to welcome you all for this first ASAMI India seminar. And I see a lot of people are, logged on to this thing. So the topic for today is management of infected non-Indians. Now, Dr. Mangal is our esteemed speaker, and Dr. Mangal Parihar, everyone knows Dr. Mangal Parihar. His name does not, everyone knows it. So Dr. Mangal is one of the senior most member of ASAMI India, and he is known for his education for ASAMI. And Dr. Mangal is from Mumbai, and he is having his own center of limb lengthening and reconstruction in Mumbai. And incidentally, when I started my career, I first went to Dr. Mangal Parihar to learn the tricks of ASAMI. And he is one great teacher, which, it is very difficult to find. So I welcome Dr. Mangal. Dr. Mangal, you are with us?
Yeah.
Okay, now I will also introduce everyone to all the panelists. Dr. Harshad Shah. He is a very senior orthopedic surgeon, and he has trained more than 300 orthopedic postgraduates. He is working in MS Ramayya Medical College, and his main special interest is ASAMI surgery. So probably in South India, southern part of India, with Dr. Vasudevan, there are two people who have maximum work on ASAMI. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Dr. Vasudevan, I welcome you. And Dr. Vasudevan is also a very senior orthopedic surgeon. And he is very famous for his Palgar deformity course, which he has been doing for many years. And it's a regular feature. And so many people have benefited with this program. So I welcome you, sir, for this ASAMI India webinar. I welcome Dr. Ruta Kulkarni. Dr. Ruta Kulkarni is one of the female members of ASAMI India. And when I started my career, I went to Swasti Rog Pratishthan, which Dr. Founder has this thing, and I learned a lot. And I welcome Dr. Kulkarni, Dr. Ruta. Dr. Ruta. So I welcome you for this, and then I introduce now Dr. Jitendra Bhatnagar. Dr. Jitendra Bhatnagar is a very senior ASAMI surgeon. He is based in Ujjain, and he has a lot of work on osteoarthritis of the knee. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Rajesh Rohila is professor of orthopedics at Rohtak, PGIMS Rohtak. And he's very, enthusiastic about ASAMI. He does a lot of ASAMI surgery. And recently, he has two publications on ASAMI in JDJS. So I welcome you, Dr. Rohila. Dr. Srinivas Reddy.
Hi. Hello.
He is a very, very senior orthopedic surgeon and dedicated to ASAMI work. And Dr. Reddy is working in Vijayawada. He is also a professor of orthopedics at one of the medical colleges there. I welcome you, sir.
Hi.
And Dr. Anil Mahajan. Dr. Anil Mahajan.
Dr. Mahajan has not joined yet, sir.
No, he is not there.
He was there. He will join later on. You can continue.
Okay, and Dr. Mahajan is also a practicing orthopedic surgeon who is interested in ASAMI work, and he is based in Indore. I welcome Dr. Satish Nesari. Dr. Satish Nesari is professor of orthopedics in Belgaum Medical College, and he has a lot of ASAMI work, and I welcome
him. Thank you, sir.
And what... Dr. Ravi, Dr. Agarwal have joined in or not?
Dr. Rajat and Dr. R Agarwal is joining. You just continue. They will join. I have just spoken to them.
Okay. I request Dr. Mangal Parihar to give us tips and tricks over the infected nodule part. He will, and I request him to be simple, so that the crowd, which we have a huge crowd, which is on. Dr. Mangal.
आ गया क्या?
या या सर.
यस सर.
I want mine to become small. Mangal Parihar.
सर शेयर नहीं हुआ अभी.
हाँ?
शेयर नहीं हुआ आपका स्क्रीन.
Mangal sir, please share your screen.
Yeah,
we got it.
Okay. So we've got a bunch of big lot of experts really, who are going to show us cases in relation to the use of Elisera for infected non-union. So I've decided that I'm going to just be talking on the infection part, because that sometimes tends to be stressed a little less. And then the people who are presenting the cases can talk more about their own, what way of fixation, what bone transport, or how they've provided, etc. So I'm going to limit, I'm going to keep my talk short only in relation to the infection. So one thing that I'm always looking at when I'm dealing with an infected non-union is that, at the very least, minimum that should happen is, once I've finished the debridement, there should be no infection sort of remaining. That should be the minimum, that I convert it from an infected non-union into only a non-union. Even that is a sort of victory. So we'll try and look in detail as to what and how to take out, how we determine the area of resection, and in which situations you will consider taking out an entire segment of bone. Because that's another area where a lot of people are worried. Oh, if I take out this whole thing, then I will have a gap, etc. So you probably need to be sure of what you're taking out. Gaps can always be filled by the Elisera and other methods. So this word thorough debridement is often bandied about. But what is really thorough debridement? As you see in this particular case, patient comes to me after about 3-4 weeks with an external fixator in situ, and there is a big sort of sinus there. On the X-ray, you can see bone, you can see the callus section. So in this kind of a situation, which is the amount of bone that you are going to remove? Are you going to remove just a small amount here, or you are going to remove a large amount here? If you remove this large amount, that's great. That's going to take away all the bone. But in general, you also want to keep a balance between the amount of bone that you take out, because the more bone you take out, the more time it takes to regenerate, right? So you have to have a balance between too timid and too aggressive. Remember that all the sclerosis that you see on the X-ray is not necessarily dead bone. Okay, I'll show you that in a bit. One of the investigations I have found useful is to do a PET CT, because not only does it deliver the radioactive compound to the area of infection, but because you have a CT, you can see a sort of three-dimensional image in terms of what is happening. MRI, I tend to use only in a case with hematogenous osteomyelitis. If it is a post-traumatic or the common types of infected non-unions that we see, I prefer a PET CT. Now, before you go in itself, when you go in, dead bone will be obvious, but even before you go in, you can start making plans in terms of what appears to be infected. If you look at both of these slides where these triangles are pointing, you can see that the area of bone over there is being eroded.
And this is the X-ray evidence of granulation tissue, which is trying to resorb that bone. So even if before I go in, I have a reasonable idea of how much bone is going to come out, I can advise the patient as to, you know, what kind of a gap is going to be there, and because of that, what is the kind of time that we are going to be dealing with. So when you do a PET CT, the radioactive material lodges in the areas of infection, and as you can see in that axial cut, which is going gradually, you can actually see what are the areas and the extent, proximal to distal extent, that needs to be covered. Now, for example, in this CT, you can see that it's right in, there are areas of bone which will need to come out, which are adjacent to that. I also use methylene blue. Once the patient is induced and draped, I will take sterile methylene blue in a 5cc syringe, push that into the sinus, try to seal the space between the nozzle of the syringe and the sinus as well as I can so that all of it goes in. Inject that with methylene blue and then hold the gauze piece there for 4-5 minutes so that if you take it out immediately, the methylene blue just flows out. So this stains all of the tissues, gives you a good idea as to what is the soft tissue and the sinus area that you have to take out, because all the area which is stained with methylene blue, you want to take it out. Then excise the sinus along with whatever infected edges of the skin are there, and this excision goes straight down to the bone. And once you have excised that soft tissue, this is usually what you find. And if the patient has come late to you, it's very easy to differentiate. Nature has done half the job for you, demarcating the dead bone from the area that is vascular and will survive. So you need to take out that dead bone. One trick which I find useful is just hold the dead bone with a ronger and twist it. Because of the vascular front between the vascular bone and the avascular bone, this bone tends to break away on its own. Right? It's you just have to twist it rather than cutting it. Then you need good sharp curettes, not those small ENT curettes. You need proper orthopedic curettes of various sizes, which are sharp, and you have to check from time to time that you are able to actually scrape stuff. It should not be the curette which you bought at the opening of your hospital and then have not changed it. You need to either get it sharpened or get new ones from time to time. Osteotomes to further demarcate. Now in that, from that same X-ray, I am finding the plane between that new bone which is not infected and this dead infected bone which needs to come out. And finally, again, a good curettage. You can see the size of this curette, the fact that I'm using two hands with a lot of power in that, because the one area where we tend to make a mistake is leaving biofilm in. So all the biofilm needs to come out in a very thorough fashion, because that is the reservoir of infection. Once it is out, then you are left with the gap which you need to deal with. And here, for enhancing local antibiotic delivery, I prefer to use either bone cement or Stimulan, which is a calcium sulfate beads, into which you can put various antibiotics. Now, usually before I take up this case, 5-7 days earlier, I will have done an aspiration in theater and got a culture with sensitivity. So I know what antibiotics I'm going to use. There will be occasionally times when you don't get a culture, right? And how do you ensure that you're going to get a culture is, one, you should inoculate it in growth media in the theater itself. So usually we talk to the microbiologist, they will send across a couple of this thing containers with the transport and enriching broth. We inoculate it in there. The microbiologist will do a extended culture. They don't throw it away after 3 days. 5-7 days they will culture it, because a lot of these organisms which are sort of shy to grow will grow in enriched media at a longer time. So once I know what is to be added, generally I will add that. If not, then I add vancomycin and tobramycin to the calcium sulfate. In this particular case, where do I use calcium sulfate? If I don't intend to go in again, for example, if there's not a big gap and I'm just going to dock it and keep it compressed, then I will tend to use only the beads, because then that saves me going in again to open up and take out the cement. But if there is a gap, then I may use cement cylinder as I've used over here to create a sort of area where I can go in and put in a graft if needed, or it also forms a good cylinder for a bone transport, depending. So here we've used the cylinder, and in addition, in the soft tissues, I have put the calcium sulfate. So you can use both, but if there's no gap, generally I will tend to use only the beads. The fixation can be with various methods. There are sometimes situations where you may use an internal fixation, rare but not impossible. But commonly, whenever there is a gap, wherever there is significant infection, it will be some form of a fixator. And the other cases that we talk about will bring that across, I'm sure. Now, when you're dealing with periarticular infections or periarticular fragments rather, it's a good idea, at least in the preliminary time, to extend it across the joint so that you've got a good fixation. It's not very easy to get a stable fixation on a very small fragment like this. So I will not hesitate to extend it across the joint if required. Now, if that entire segment is infected, as was in this case, or it is non-viable, then you have to take out that entire segment. If after your debridement, only less than 2/3 of the diameter of the bone is remaining, which means essentially it's going to be an unstable area, that also you may remove. So the worry which people have, and because of which they leave bone, is that, oh, that will leave a gap. Then what will I do? It doesn't matter. If you've got infected bone, that bone needs to come out. So getting rid of the infection is the first issue. Filling that bone gap by either bone transport or anything else is always a later problem. So you have to do the first part of the surgery, that is getting rid of the infection properly. There are multiple ways of getting rid of the infection. Like in this patient who had an infected segment, which you can see obviously over here. And also this was a very thin sort of shell. This was less than 2/3 diameter. So according to me, this also needs to go out. And if I look at it closely, there are areas of erosion, right? So when we went in, this is all infected bone, which is not infected and dead. So it's not going to contribute to the union. So that needs to come out. Otherwise, you're just going to spend time waiting for that to settle. So local antibiotic beads stabilized with a relatively simple fixator to give it stability. And now, if you look at this, this gap is 20 centimeters. Transport can be done. Technically, it's a little challenging. Time-wise, also, it takes a long time. So for a 20 centimeter gap, you'd be looking at about 20 months in terms of getting this to heal. So in a city like Mumbai, I have access to a microvascular surgeon, so I would fill this in with, a microvascular fibula. But this can be tackled. I'm sure Rajesh or someone else will show you a case where bone transport from both sides is done for a case like this. But with a vascularized fibula, things get relatively simpler, and that same fixator is maintained. when you use the fibula intramedullary like this, then you don't have to do any fancy or crazy fixations like screws, etc. The fibula inside the intramedullary cavity is a very stable construct when it is supplemented by a relatively simple fixator also. So this is 4 months post-removal. I think he was with the fixator, walking, etc., with the fixator for about 6 months. And this is 4 months after that was removed. This does take time to hypertrophy. But during that time, the patient can very well be with some sort of a brace. So in summary, the most important thing, I think, in dealing with an infection, and really that's the difference between dealing with an infected and an aseptic non-union, where debridement has to be thorough. And this is something which one learns with experience. The first 5 or 6 cases that you do, you might find that you have to go back again and do, repeat debridement. As you get better, as you get more experience, you will find that one debridement is all it takes for you to do, except in some rare cases. So, as I said before, you should try and determine preoperatively, clinically, as well as with imaging, how much bone you want to take out. Do not hesitate to take off a segment of bone if required, because getting rid of the infection is your primary goal. There's no harm in staging treatment. Sometimes people worry that, okay, in this infected, can I do an osteotomy? If you are worried about it, you can do the osteotomy 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks later. And the cases that are coming, I'm sure you will see the multiple ways to treat the gap that results from the excision of bed bone. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mangal. Thank you, Dr. Mangal. Hello, can you hear me, sir?
We can hear you. Somebody has two devices at one time. Okay, go ahead, sir.
Sir, Dr. Mangal, we'll take few questions. My question is with you. Dr. Mangal, can you hear me?
I can hear you, yeah.
Sir, once you have put the beads or you have put the cement, antibiotic cement, this thing, you feel that infection is now, the sinuses have closed, how much time, long time you keep the beads, or when do you remove it? What is that acceptable time limit to remove the beads and the cement, antibiotic cement?
Antibiotic cement, which is there, normally I would try and take it out by about 6 to 8 weeks, because beyond that, I don't think there is too much of elution. Beyond that, your membrane has formed. So I will try and use that for 6 to 8 weeks. If you wait for too long, also the problem, one of the problems, especially with beads, is that there's a lot of fibrosis that forms around the beads. It becomes deadly difficult to take it out. So beads generally I tend not to use. I would use a cylinder to fill up, you know, gaps and defects. And the rest of it, like you saw in this case, I will tend to use the stimulant beads, which are resorbable. So I don't have to go after that.
Do you also, the biofilm is there. Do you utilize the biofilm if suppose you have to do the graft? So you retain that biofilm also?
No, not really. I would take out the biofilm is soft tissue that all comes out, but what people call as local bone graft, I really don't trust that too much unless it's obviously uninfected. But generally speaking, I will tend not to use that because I can grow any amount of bone I want with the elixir of principle. So I don't see a big advantage to using that small amount of graft.
Okay.
One question from my side to Mangal sir. Hello?
Yes.
Yeah. In infected non-unions, you prefer staged procedure or a single stage?
I would say 8 out of 10 cases, I would do it in a single stage. If the infection is not sort of terrible, if the organism is susceptible to antibiotics, which I can give, and now I'm confident about my debridement. So I will do it. I will do the debridement, stabilization, as well as the corticotomy, all in one go. But 2 out of 10 cases where I'm a little worried about, or the infection is recalcitrant, I would wait. But I wouldn't fight with anyone who says that I'm going to stage all my cases. That's also a appropriate way of approaching it. I don't have a problem with that.
And that's more important than infected nails.
Yes.
Sir, my next, I think Dr. Ruta wants to ask a question, then I'll ask one question. Dr. Ruta?
Yeah, Mangal, you said you do pre-operative culture. So I wonder how useful is that, because they say you should always take culture from deeper tissues and fluids. Yes, yes.
So this culture is taken, this is an aspiration in theater from the depth of the tissue.
Okay.
Not a superficial swab. Oh, and you need to take the patient to theater, put a needle in from intact skin, not even from the sinus, but into the area of the non-union, aspirate, and then send that for culture.
Dr. Mangal, what is the role of antibiotic nail? Because it is also very popular that you take a K nail of 7 or 8 size, and then you put antibiotic cement over it and implant it. What is the role of it?
Absolutely. I mean, if you have done a nailing and 2 weeks, 3 weeks later, you find that there is a significant infection, then using an antibiotic nail is absolutely fine, because there you have not. If you deal with it in appropriate time, then you can clear up the infection. So it's not necessary that for every infected non-union, you have to use an alizarov. You could use an antibiotic nail if that is giving you the stability that is required. But it has to be done early enough. Too late, a case like this, using an antibiotic nail is not really going to work. So especially when there is the liability or the possibility of a gap, there Elizarov principles will obviously come into play. Other situations where a nail has been used, you can use an antibiotic nail.
Okay, sir. There now we'll take a few questions from the audience. So
One question from me, sir.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Mangal, do you decide the muscular technique or bone transport, which one to do, depending upon the bone gap in femur?
Yes.
Is the guideline that after 10 centimeter bone gap, you will do musculate, or up to 10 centimeter, you will do bone transport? Is there some criteria regarding bone gap?
Not really. Personally, I would tend to do a bone transport, because in my hands, that is more reliable compared to a masculine. Okay. I do a bone transport, the only issue I will have is docking site, because the regenerate will form without trouble. Whereas if I'm doing a large gap with the masculine, then I have trouble of where am I going to get the bone graft from? Where am I going to get the allograft from? The volume of bone becomes an issue.
Well, you have told that you have used the vascularized fibula also, yes, and non-vascularized. Which one is better in your opinion?
For a long gap like this, I will not use non-vascularized. Non-vascularized only in children. Okay. But otherwise, I would always use vascularized, because the non-vascularized will have the same problems as a transport in terms of time. The risk of stress fractures while creeping substitution is occurring, etc., is much, much higher for a non-vascularized. So I would not use a non-vascularized fibula in general. I have had 2 cases where the anastomosis has failed, and there sort of, out of no other option, we've used it. But usually not. Those patients didn't have any problems with the skin. It was only the bone gap. So those patients, we kind of got away. But otherwise, I would always use a vascularized.
Dr. Mangal,
sir, one more question.
Wait. I think we have to take 1 or 2 questions from the audience also.
Yeah, sure.
So let first take that, and then we have a lot to go. So one question which has come, that is there any difference of for fixated period for infected non-union management rather than infection alone?
Infected non-union versus?
Rather than infection alone. What the question is that, first question. So
I mean, if it's an infected non-union where there is no gap, etc., then I would say, you know, it's like 4 or 5 months in terms of healing. In case of a gap, then the gap will dictate how much time it's going to take. And normally we say at least 1.5 months per centimeter. But I would say if there are other comorbidities, I say 1.5 to 2 months per centimeter is what you are looking at before the fixator comes off.
Okay, sir, one more question from the audience. He says that, can you explain that, what is the difference between the antibiotic bone and the calcium sulfate which you use it? What is your preference for each for the case? When did you use calcium sulfate one? When do you use
calcium sulfate when I don't want to go, when I don't need to go in again, then I will use calcium sulfate.
Okay.
If I am planning to, if there is a small gap, for example, where I'm planning to do a bone grafting, then I would use a bone cement. Or in some situations where there is a largish gap, then I may use a bone cement to form a tube there into which then I will do a bone transport.
Okay, and one audience wants to know that which is preferable, PET CT or MRI?
I think a PET CT.
PET CT.
Because MRI is useful only in hematogenous osteomyelitis, but in our situations of post-traumatic infected non-unions, I think a PET CT gives us more information.
Sir, do you consider paprika sign when you are doing the debridement?
Paprika sign when I am doing debridement? No. If I don't take out only the surface of the bone, I take out the entire, and the one trick which I showed you where you twist the bone off, that tends to help me. And if I have a doubt, I would err on the side of taking out a little more bone rather than less. Now, paprika sign to me is when you are taking off the surface of the bone and looking for bleeding sides. Paprika sign is okay when you are doing an aseptic non-union and you're taking off that periosteum along with the callus, etc., etc. So there, paprika sign is okay. For this situation, I don't think there is any real role for a paprika sign.
Sir, if there is a very large gap, is there any role of gradual transport of fibula?
Transporting? Yes, there is, I think. But I don't have any personal experience. I think Vasu has probably done that. I know of. If anyone else has done, they can share their experience. I think it's a good way to do it, but I have not had a chance to do it as yet. Because in most of my cases with the tibia, I have access to a good plastic surgeon, and doing a fibula then and there, microvascular fibula, works well for me. But ask the others if they have any experience, Rajesh or anyone else.
I have done one case.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
I also have done one case. It works. And,
but the difficulty is...
It's difficult. But I have only experience of one case. So, I can't comment much that what are the...
Satish has a case. You are showing that case, Satish?
Yeah.
No, sir.
I'm going to show.
Okay. Now, and Dr. Mangal, one more question. When you are in case of infected non-union of femur, if you are using the very distal condyle is remaining, and if you take a knee spanning fixator, when do you remove the tibial ring? Is there any time or when do you want to remove that knee because the knee joint is spanned?
Oftentimes, by the time the case has come to us, multiple infection, etc., the knee is already stiff. So I am not very bothered about getting back knee movement. But I would say around 6 to 8 weeks is the minimum that I would keep it, depending on how well I am able to fix the distal fragment.
Sir, one question that, you have any experience of modified Judet procedure for quadriceps contracture following infection or illegal?
Yes.
Sir, can you elaborate, sir?
I mean, it works well when you have infection when you have scarring of the quadriceps onto the femur and onto the distal femur and the shaft of the femur, once you lift up that entire thing. But I would not do that at least till for you know, a year and a half after it has healed without infection. But that is a good, either that or a Thompson's is a good procedure. If your non-union was distal and it is stuck down into the suprapatellar area, into the entire shaft of the femur, then you have to do a modified Judase.
Then the stiffness can be corrected with using ortho-SUV?
Not really. I mean, if not when you have had infection and everything is plastered down, that is, I think, extending the indications of Elisarov too far. Yes, you can do an open procedure and then use the fixator to get the patient moving, you know, on a regular basis. But to get it moving, you have to do open surgery according to
that. Sir, you have any experience of mescalate technique?
I do. Not very good though.
Not
I don't know whether it is a problem with the way I do it.
No, actually, I also feel that masculine is inferior to Elisarov bone transport and this thing. So, what I now suggest that we stop the questions now. We'll go to the case presentation and then we, at the end, we will take the questions.
Right.
So, I request Dr. Harshad Shah. Dr. Harshad?
Ram, yes, I'm ready here.
Yes, please show your case.
Share screen.
Meanwhile, I have a question, sir, for Mangal Parihar, sir.
Talk in between.
Harsha, sir, share your screen.
Yeah, I'm trying. Which one?
Sir, your presentation
is open. Sir, Mangal Parihar, sir.
Yes.
Sir, do you have any experience with internal fixation as a definitive procedure after debridement and control of the infection?
Yes.
How are the results, sir? What are the chances of reinfection?
If you get it early enough and your debridement is good and you use local antibiotics, then you can use